Pity me, gentle viewer. I spent a good few months methodically building up the media section of our channel and establishing, I hope, a reputation as a firm but fair critic of modern film and television. Only for my colleague to come along and dump this masterwork in the art of hot takes and cause an almighty shitstorm in the comments section. It's safe to say the response hasn't been uniformly positive. This figure has fluctuated between 40 and 60% in the last couple of weeks since the Batman's debut on HBO Max brought a new wave of viewers to our channel. That in itself is kind of interesting, because it suggests, and the comments under that video will attest to the fact, that the Batman has divided the audience. Not discounting the vast grey blob in the middle that thought it was just alright, most of the online commentary is split between those who, apparently, orgasmed several times in the cinema and left with sticky trousers, and those who threw up and left in disgust. Given that's the case, and that I do most of our film coverage anyway, I thought the time was ripe for me to finally sit down and watch it for myself. I'll be honest in saying I am suffering a bit of superhero fatigue, and I've been reluctant to see this film partly because of its length, but also because I really wasn't sure we had any need of another Batman reboot. But I had to see what all the fuss was about, and also to evaluate my colleague's take and pose and then answer the following question. Was he wrong about the Batman? Was this film actually a masterpiece? Or was it, as he suggested, a big pile of shit? My colleague has yet to settle on an appropriate screen name or nom de plume, and so he will henceforth be referred to as Dick for the purposes of this video. Dick made a number of points in his video, which I encourage you to check out for reference. Some of these were assertions, and some were arguments. The audience, likewise, made a number of points in response, some of which were intelligent, and many of which had about as much intellectual heft as your average Zack Snyder film. By a curious coincidence, most of these were in fact fans of Zack Snyder films, which explains quite a lot, actually. To those who said something along the lines of, L, take the L, lol, this is an L, you're the reason the dislike button was removed, and you're watching movies wrong, I'm going to put in as much effort in responding to you now as you put into your comments.
Go away!
To those who said all art is subjective, so you can't say films are bad, and therefore Dick's review was bad, you need to go and reread your own argument. Alternatively, I'll take this exceptionally rare opportunity to say, take it from the philosophy grad, you're wrong. Some people who uniformly agreed with Dick's position countered with the most worthwhile response, which is that there is a difference between a film's objective quality and your subjective enjoyment of it. This is, with qualifications, true. Most sentient people enjoy films they know are objectively bad. I quite like The Dark Knight Rises, and that is objectively a piss-poor film. To make this clear from the off, this is the position from which I am proceeding in this video. You are allowed to enjoy the film, whatever my answers happen to be, but the fact you enjoyed it does not make it an objectively good film. All of you out there who like Zack Snyder films are proof of this all-important distinction. When Dick says he prefers the animated Batman or Nolan's Batman, that is, first and foremost, a subjective preference. You can substantiate it, and we'll try here to do so, or not, as the case may be, based on how objectively well-written the different versions happen to be. But there will always be a large amount of subjective preference at play when comparing the different iterations of Batman. That dispenses with one of the other frequent arguments Dick's video was met with, namely that he doesn't understand the character of Batman. Well, which Batman? There is no one Batman, there have been many. I would say probably too many, in recent times at least. To say you prefer one does not mean you misunderstand the others. To say you prefer Snyder's Batfleck, fucking Batfleck, does not invalidate somebody else's preference for the Nolan-era character unless you can explain why Snyder's Batfleck is objectively better. Which you can't, because it's Zack Snyder's Batfleck, and that man cannot write good films or good characters. Besides all that, Dick made the following points in his video, and these are the ones I propose here to test. Number 1. The animated version is better. Number 2. The soundtrack is derivative, ripping off part of Hans Zimmer's score for the Nolan films. Number 3. Robert Pattinson's Batman is good, but his Bruce Wayne is bad, to the extent there is a Bruce Wayne at all. Number 4. The batsuit functions as plot armor in this film, is far too advanced for its stage of development, and is otherwise enabling a number of contrivances. Number 5. The film is too long, and characters like Batwoman are included with little justification besides their use as plot devices. Number 6. The random woke insert is irritating. Number 7. The Riddler is a poorly handled villain with precious little screen time and an insufficient backstory and a mediocre master plan. And finally, number 8. The film ultimately does a disservice to Batman as a character. I'm sure there'll be other things to comment on, but in the interests of brevity, I'll try and restrict myself to those in roughly that order. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have to go and watch the film. The question before the house is this. Were we wrong about the Batman?
3 hours later.
I'll combine points 1 and 3 first and say that, though I'm not qualified to judge the animated show, on the comparative merits of the different Batmen, we can at least establish some of the basics of objectively good character writing and see how Matt Reeves' film holds up. A base must be sufficiently well established that all subsequent actions are intelligible to and understood by the audience and of a piece with the character as we understand him. Even characters whose point is to be unpredictable, think the Joker and the Nolan films, must have consistent underlying motivations. You shouldn't require pages of hackneyed exposition in dialogue or in voiceover to make the letters E, F, G make sense in sequence. If they follow properly from A, B, C, D, the audience can be relied upon to fill in whatever gaps they might perceive, because such gaps as do exist are small ones, filled by implication and by our knowledge of the setup. Heroes in classical writing have the heroic arc. They go on a very definite journey. Their ultimate triumph is a payoff for the growth, the highs and the lows that we've witnessed across the film. The Batman is a deceptively complicated character to write because you are really writing two characters that are inextricably linked. The Batman-Bruce Wayne dynamic is like Two-Face, actually, but without the element of psychopathic luck involved. You do actually have to establish what links two sides of the face, where and how they are the same, where and how they are separate. The Nolan films did this reasonably well. For the avoidance of doubt, comment section, yes, I am aware these are two different versions of the character, and the portrayals are designed to evoke different things. But there is a problem of separation in The Batman that you don't encounter in earlier iterations. It's forgivable to a degree, but not in its entirety. Batman in The Batman is not quite at the beginning of his arc, as he was in the first Nolan film, and the Batman does deserve credit for not rehashing the origin story yet again, but we're in the peculiar position of having the Batman ego much more established here than the Bruce Wayne ego is, which poses logical problems given that Bruce, unlike the Batman, is not born with the death of his parents. He has years of life before that moment, and in this film, a few years after it as well. He has to carry a pre-established personality into this film to account for his actual history. But for the precious little time Bruce Wayne is actually on screen here, what we get is a character with less depth than the alter ego he has only recently assumed. This isn't to say we need the same Bruce Wayne as we saw in the Nolan films. Bruce here is a different portrayal to begin with, but specifically, a character who hasn't fully developed as a person. He's scornful of his inheritance, he doesn't splash the cash, he doesn't flaunt it, he is not all that interested in himself, which is all fine. There's time and room for him to develop. Though it is worth noting that for narrative purposes, the Nolan version benefits from establishing the contrast early on. Bruce Wayne is the character as much, if not more, than the Batman. In-universe because it serves as cover, but out-universe because it gives the character and the film an appealing personality, something that the audience can actually like and get on with. The problem with Bruce Wayne in The Batman isn't that it lacks the room to grow, it's that it hasn't grown yet. Mopey emo Bruce only really has one dimension to him. He's a mopey emo. Understandable, the guy has lost his parents, he has no moral center. But that shouldn't be all there is to his character, because it wouldn't be. Even real life emos have more evident personality than him with half the life experience. But also, it gives the audience little reason to invest in this side of his character. there is no character in which to invest. The film is obviously more interested in the Batman alter ego. Its approach, and the defense I've heard of its approach, is that the Batman really is the character. Hell, this is the Riddler's own diagnosis at the end of the film. The Batman ego is the one who has an evident moral journey. He's the one who develops, and that's fine. The film does it reasonably well. But the point of Batman since his inception as a character, as far as I understand it anyway, has always been that there are two characters in one body. Those characters are played differently. The emphasis is weighted here or there across the variations. But there are always two characters, even if one just proves to be a front. And there are ways the Batman could have achieved the same effect with the Batman ego while not neglecting Bruce Wayne. Ultimately, the film needs to disprove the Riddler's supposition rather than confirm it. Again, there are things to like about this characterization, objectively as well as subjectively, but on the criticism of this film's portrayal of Bruce, I'm minded to say Dick was mostly right. On the soundtrack, I will say that Dick got it wrong. The composer, Michael Giacchino, is, in fact, a pretty derivative kind of guy. It's got him a lot of work. He's one of those being lined up as a long-term successor to John Williams, hence being drafted in to score Rogue One and Jurassic World. The former was alright, the latter lackluster. He has some good, even some exceptional work to his name. The Incredibles, in particular, has an excellent score, though it is again still derivative. And some of his Marvel tunes are passable, and the theme from the Star Trek reboot is probably the only memorable thing about it. These are all, in various ways, derivative, but then most film music is. The trick to originality is how closely you match the source material, how obviously you're borrowing or stealing, and how many disparate influences you can combine in order to eliminate that effect. The more influences you have, the more disparate they are, the more original the resulting score. John Williams himself is often derivative, sometimes even of his own themes, but mostly from classical composers. The original Star Wars score is very Gustav Holst. His general approach to themes, the leitmotif, is Wagnerian, but he has the dual gifts of an expansive knowledge and a knack for a tune, and he has become much more complex in his range of inspirations over time. There's nothing especially objectionable about the score for the Batman. I didn't notice much by way of resemblance with the Zimmer scores until maybe the second act, and even then it was scant. The fact Hans Zimmer is one of the most overrated composers out there is a video for another time. But as is so often the case with Giacchino's original work, there's just nothing particularly memorable about it. The main theme, whether inverted from the Zimmer film scores or not, is hardly noticeable. The Batman score just doesn't stick in the mind. None of it does. Can you hum me any part of the soundtrack? I thought not. But given the claim was specifically that it derived too much influence from Zimmer, I find against Dick in this instance. Dick's point about the batsuit invited the accusation that he was nitpicking. But it's not nitpicking to point out when something clearly serves as plot armor, and the batsuit does. Plot armor is forgivable as a narrative device only if it doesn't pose obvious questions, such as, why does Batman in this film clearly feel the impact of bullets toward the beginning, the blunt force trauma knocking him around a bit, even if they don't penetrate the suit, yet remain largely unharmed when that force is magnified significantly, such as when he crashes into solid objects at very high speed? Sometimes these things affect him, such as when he gets blown up in the church, but other equivalent and even bigger impacts do not, such as his squirrel suit crash. Bale's Batman wore wounds. Wounds are a relatively subtle and simple way of filling out the man behind the mask, and it wouldn't have been too difficult for this film to show a bit more of Bruce's physical suffering. But it doesn't, preferring to use plot armor wherever and whenever is necessary, that he not take too long to recover from what should, by what passes for the mechanics of this universe, have caused him much more damage. The short-form version of this point is that it is not nitpicking to say that the film's internal logic, its internal mechanics, are not consistent. That is something quite important. It's what establishes believability. It's what makes you expect things, and reasonably expect things. All universes need a consistent internal logic and mechanics if they are to be ultimately believable and avoid posing awkward questions, which this film does and which it cannot answer. Speaking of that church scene, the Batman is unconscious in the presence of the police for a good long while, but Nobody thinks of removing his mask until after he's awake, which goes about as well as you might expect. The leeway given to Commissioner Gordon by the rest of the force in his relationship with and defense of Batman seems quite extraordinary, but that criticism isn't strictly relevant to this point. It is a superhero film, so you're prepared to forgive it when it does take liberties with physics, but the suit is ludicrously strong when the action is designed to be impressive but inconsequential, then made significantly weaker when the film wants to manufacture stakes or inject peril. Again, it is not nitpicking to point out selective invincibility, because selective invincibility is objectively bad writing. I'd argue, again, that the Nolan films, though far from being perfect in this regard, do handle the suit better, not least because they actually take the time to explain it and show how it develops to compensate for weaknesses identified during the course of the films. You can also raise the question, as Dick does in his video, of where this suit came from. How did Bruce get hold of it? Why, given he's only had this nighttime occupation for a couple of years, is it so advanced? I wouldn't personally raise this as a significant fault. I've already praised the film for dispensing with a rehash of Bruce's origin story, and it's acceptable, especially given how many recent versions of the character we've had, to jump into things mid-story. But it does rankle a bit that the suit is as it is without any explanation, or indeed any development of its own. Batman, like Iron Man, is one of those heroes for whom the armor serves as an extension of the character. It explains their methods and personalities, and ideally it develops as they develop. Again, the point of this film, according to its defenders, who side with the Riddler on this point, is that Batman is the character and Bruce Wayne is the front. In which case, the suit literally is an integral part of his character and must develop. But it doesn't. Development of armor in the case of Batman and Iron Man explains methods and personalities and develops, as we've said, as they develop. You wouldn't need to make a big deal of this, but a little bit would have gone a long way. So on this point, all in all, I'll give Dick 7 out of 10 for accuracy. Now to the subject of the Riddler. His long absences from proceedings didn't, in fact, bother me all that much. The Batman takes an awful lot of inspiration, too much, I'd argue, and as we'll see, from 7, in which Kevin Spacey's villain is similarly at a remove from the main plot. This is, after all, a detective story. In a more straightforward action flick, again, the Nolan films, it's acceptable to give the Joker a lot of on-screen time because discovering the Joker accounts for a relatively minor part of the plot. Detective stories function differently. They must function differently, trading with significantly more weight on the unravelling of a mystery, the reveal of which is the villain. Nolan's Batman was always destined to fight the Joker, and certainly Bane. Reeves' Batman has to find the Riddler. The audience benefits from this as well, because the mystery is, after all, the point of the thing. We see the Riddler by his effects, and we see the consequences of his actions as opposed to his actions in the moment. As with Seven, and indeed any good detective story, this approach is what builds up the stakes, it's what gets us invested in the plot, or rather, the unwinding of a plot. It's what establishes that sense of desperation, of powerlessness, that makes you want to solve the crime before more crime is committed. You can't sit back in the knowledge that the Batman and the Riddler are predetermined to meet and to fight, as in the case of Bane particularly, but the Joker also, in the Nolan films. The Joker is manipulative to be sure, but the Riddler orchestrates much more by remove. We get to see the Joker lay his plans in motion. He's much more immediate a character. The Riddler, like Spacey's villain in Seven, isn't seen unless and until he wants to be. That being said, and leading into the criticism of the film's length, it overdoes this narrative device, taking far too long to get to the payoff and filling the intervening time with a succession of action sequences, some of which are overblown, and twists in the grand design, many of which are unnecessary. There is a balance to be struck in any detective story between complexity and pacing. If complexity strays into being convoluted, which the Batman has to do to justify its length, it renders large parts of the audience bored, confused, or both. Seven, and the film plays so heavily on it, so I will too, achieves at least as much as the Batman while being an hour shorter. It's to the Batman's credit that it doesn't fall into stasis, it doesn't stop moving, it does find ways to fill the time, but a good deal of what happens does not need to happen. The payoff isn't made any greater for it happening. It doesn't contribute anything. Once you've achieved a certain amount of complexity in the build-up, once you've done so many riddles, Once you've established so much about the Riddler's character and his motivations, there comes a point where there are no more marginal gains to be had from adding more. For every one person who can't get enough of this stuff, there will be two or three who leave the theatre either bored stiff or else, not uncommon it must be said in the comments under Dick's video, inclined to criticise the length of the film even if they loved the rest. The Riddler himself is a curious character. To the film's credit, it drip-feeds information across its first third, maybe its first half, at about the right rate. He's seldom physically present, but rarely is he out of the narrative long enough for you to forget about him. It does begin to lose its way from around the halfway point, having so many threads to unwind that you lose track of the spool. It's at around this point you find yourself in the position of God in Monty Python's Holy Grail.
Get on with it!
And all this does, in the end, detract from the Riddler's character. Given he has to be defined entirely in his physical absence, his absence from the narrative for an extended period in the second act is damaging. And when things come to a head, it gets very silly. Online chat rooms and alt-right message boards are a particular bugbear of the news media and blue checks on Twitter, who always seem to assume they pose more of a threat than they do. Which must be the case, because they by and large pose no threat at all. If 4chan had the kind of power these people think it has, the world would have come to an end, probably drowning in Pepe memes, a long time ago. 4chan as an archetype is portrayed as a kind of ISIS-style recruiting site. We seldom portray actual ISIS-style recruiting sites, but it's safe to do so when the villains are basement-dwelling chubby white nerds, and the Batman decides to equip a few hundred message board trolls with the convictions of Islamist nutters. The Batman's deployment of this media myth is just lazy writing. And this section of the film, the Riddler's big reveal, consists in little if not lazy writing, it having given up any pretense at originality in favour of a full-scale rehash of Seven. It's a shame because the Riddler's setup has been, as mentioned, reasonably good throughout this seemingly endless film. It required, it deserved, a payoff more imaginative than, hey, what if that Kevin Spacey character, let's take him, but also make him an alt-right troll. Couple that with Paul Dano's turn toward a much more Joker-like performance, and you get the sense that the film is now done with innovation, it's run out of ideas. It wants to bring all this to a close. And after nearly 3 hours, doesn't everyone? But regrettably, it's decided to do that thing all undergrad writers do when they realise they've spent so long padding an essay to reach the word count that they're nearing the deadline with a lot left to say. Copy-paste, 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 reword the odd bit, remove the Wikipedia references, but copy-paste, 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 and submit. And they're not even copy-pasting the good bits. What we've had thus far is a character-rich plot. The Riddler is a psychological manipulator intent on bringing down the Batman as a person as much as a concept, and the genius of Seven is that Kevin Spacey's ultimate victory is the destruction of a hero. The Batman has borrowed more from that film than was sensible, but if it was to borrow anything, it probably should have been that. That motive, that plan, that ending. It fits what we know now of the Riddler's character. If it's setting up a sequel or two, and its point thus far has been to display a new, dark, uncertain, and self-doubting Batman, why not round off this film with a what's-in-the-box moment? It's shown us the Batman's nascent growth, his growing certainty and surety of purpose, so why not bring him crashing down again? Wouldn't that reaffirm all of Bruce's own doubts about his character? Instead, we get a ludicrous, cheap, contrived plan to flood Gotham by blowing up the breakwaters, which could have been done at literally any moment in the last 3 hours. Mobilising the 4chan trolls to create necessary havoc, though why you would deploy them to snipe at the crowd in the shelter when you could have just blown up the shelter, as it's already been proven? I don't know, I guess the film has given up making sense. The close cheapens everything that went before it, and it leaves you wondering why you just sat through almost 3 hours of reasonably intriguing build-up only to see yet another comic book bad guy concoct a comic book villain's comic book evil scheme to blow up a city to be foiled inevitably by our brilliant hero. It's like taking Agatha Christie's Poirot and getting J.J. Abrams to direct the ending. At its best, this film has been genuinely thoughtful, but by its close, it's exhausted itself. And given this is the Riddler's master plan coming to fruition, I have to concur with Dick's assessment of him as a character. Finally then, before we move on to our conclusion, on whether the film does a disservice to who Batman is supposed to be. I think on this one, I will have to disagree with Dick. I've heard Ben Shapiro make a similar point, but it harks back to what we've already established about the different goals, purposes, and natures of the different iterations of Batman. I can't criticize some of Dick's critics for saying he didn't understand the Batman, because there is no one Batman, whilst also supporting Dick's argument that the film disgraces the one Batman. The argument is basically the same from both sides. This is not Christian Bale's Batman, it is not Michael Keaton's Batman, it's not the animated Batman, it is not, thank God, George Clooney's Batman. Each of these versions portrayed to a greater or lesser degree a different version, in some cases from an entirely different Batman lore. Matt Reeves' film does the same thing. We can argue the comparative merits of these different depictions. We can certainly say that some of the films were objectively better or worse than the others, and that certain portrayals objectively better fit with the aspects of the character that are consistent across all the different versions of the character in the comics and films, like the fact he doesn't kill. Given that he does in the Snyder versions, we can absolutely say that that depiction does a disservice to who Batman is supposed to be. But the goal of this video isn't to adjudicate between what is otherwise, in large part, a subjective preference for one type of Batman story over the other. So on this point, I disagree with Dick. There are, as we've already laid out, objective problems with the writing in and of the Batman, though these are much more apparent when it comes to the Bruce Wayne half of his ego than the Caped Crusader half. Now that we've responded to those specific points, my overall impression. There is actually a fair amount to like in the Batman. The aesthetic is deep and dirty enough to properly depict the world the writers want it to be. A Gotham City much more akin to its earlier inspirations in the New York of the grungy, crime-riddled, perpetually collapsing state of the 1970s than the overly CGI'd, semi-futuristic Gotham of Batman Begins or the modern and sleek glass skyscraping versions we see in The Dark Knight and The Dark Knight Rises. Personal aesthetic preference is largely subjective, but worlds that fit their stories can be judged on more objective grounds. This Gotham fits its story. The casting is generally solid. Colin Farrell's prosthetics and makeup are particularly effective, and there are some strong enough performances, though Pattinson's Bruce Wayne suffers from the contrast given he has as much personality as a paving slab. We have, though, finally got a Batman story that focuses somewhat less on the all-action crime-busting superheroics of the Bale iteration, at least until the end, and more on the crime-solving noir detective version of the character, which was long overdue, and the necessary departure from the recent norm. But the fact the plot borrows so much from Seven is a point against it, and detracts from what might otherwise have been a refreshingly original, on film anyway, take on the character. It's one thing not to resemble past Batman films, but too closely resembling other genre pieces is disappointing. The relationship between Commissioner Gordon and Batman works nicely. It's this more than perhaps any other element of the film that fills in a time gap, Batman's first 2 years before the film begins. That might otherwise have been jarring had it been left unaddressed. The relationship between Bruce and Alfred, on the other hand, is somewhat lacking. This is partly due, again, to the problems with Bruce's characterization and the fact they share so few scenes. Those scenes feel rather like they're trying to shoehorn in a kind of sullen self-absorption and lack of gratitude on Bruce's part. And if you're paying attention, the exchanges about Alfred not being Bruce's father, etc., telegraph Alfred's fate. When he does, spoilers, eventually get blown up by a device meant for Bruce, you know exactly what the film's going for and you saw it coming a long time ago. We've seen it in plenty of films before, that you don't know what you have until it's gone trope. Or almost gone in Alfred's case. Oh, spoilers again. But the payoff feels unearned because the film hasn't shown sufficient interest in that relationship. And I would argue it couldn't show sufficient interest in that particular dynamic given the lack of character development in Bruce. You have to actually have two characters to have a relationship, and there's only one in the scenes with Bruce and Alfred. And this does constitute objectively bad writing, because the script doesn't actually accomplish what the writers clearly intended it to. It's odd to say that anything in a 3-hour film feels rushed, but Bruce and Alfred's relationship was, compounded by the lack of anyone for Alfred to have a relationship with, and thus does what might have seemed like nitpicking in Dick's criticism of Bruce's character actually have some significant and detrimental effects on a key moment in the film. They go a considerable way toward repairing it after the fact, and the event comes to serve as Bruce Wayne's first moment of character development. around an hour and 50 minutes in. The scene in the hospital is genuinely touching, but the lack of anything like it earlier in the film robs the actual event of the meaning it should have conveyed. Some of the other characters suffer from equivalently rushed or contrived roles and relationships. Catwoman feels like she's been inserted either as an excuse for certain events to happen, or else because this is a Batman film, so she should probably feature at some point. Her motivations are shallow, which stands out given the film excuses its 3-hour runtime on the grounds that it gives time to establish depth. Her role in the plot is procedural, and at times, contrived. She does have the film's only proto-woke line as well, but I'm not sure that's really that objectionable. It is only one, it's over in a flash. The film is largely free of the kind of messaging we see in so much modern media, with the exception, of course, of the 4chan message boards. I think that's one of the reasons its fans cling so desperately to it. And it's not all that unbelievable, the line that is, coming from her character. You can't simultaneously complain that wokeness seems to be everywhere these days and then not expect any character to believe it or utter its slogans in film. It wouldn't be believable. It would be objectionable if it were a defining aspect of the film. But as it is, it's a relatively innocuous thing, and it probably tells us more about the character who speaks it, or maybe the actress who demanded the line be inserted, pure speculation of course, than it does the film she's placed in. And I think that covers pretty much all the bases that need covering in this video, and a few extra. But since we began with a question, we should probably close by answering it. Were we, or rather, was Dick, wrong about the Batman? I probably shouldn't close this with a non-committal yes and no, should I? But I almost have to. No, he wasn't wrong in that many of the criticisms raised in his video hold true. Yes, however, in that they led him to brand the Batman a complete disaster, and I don't think that can be sustained. One or two of the criticisms were wrong, in my opinion, and so shouldn't have tarnished the film in the way that they did. It's absolutely, and I'd say objectively, not as good as its fanboys would have you believe. But I wouldn't say it's as bad as Dick said it was either, though it would have been significantly better had it actually had a decent ending. The ending really was a complete disaster. Otherwise, there is merit in the film, especially in the world that it builds, giving us a more fully fleshed out look at the lesser players in Gotham's underworld that really could form the basis of a good series of films. But there is plenty wrong with it as well. Especially the ending. That is fucking abysmal. Compared to most other films doing the rounds at the moment, it's an attempt at relatively serious storytelling, until the end, that's almost always more concerned with telling a story, until the end, than it is with propagandizing some tedious political message. But on its own terms, it is a deeply flawed creation still. Anyway, now you've had both of our takes. Dick thinks it's a disaster. LostChord's less snappy verdict is that it's all right, mostly, until the end. What do you think? What's your take on the film if you've managed to sit through the whole thing? Disaster? Brilliant? Something in between? We, despite our experience in the other video, nevertheless continue to encourage your comments, so let us know what you think.